I'm just telling all you people this. We're just trying to create a scene here, man. That's all. I'll give it back. We want to get in Rolling Stone. This is all right.
Thank you. Thank you. thing.
Hey, Gary.
Who knows? Say hello to Boston.
So where the fuck are you, man?
Hi, Boston.
Check it out, we're in sunny California. Here with Bonnie.
And we're partying.
We're doing it out. She goes out to Beantown.
Say something. Got a short thought.
Can you say something nice to Gino?
I would love my
shit. Hit the water.
He did it. Did you hear it?
This ain't no MTV interview, folks.
I am a disco man.
Say light up.
Everybody put us up for Boston.
Dude, take out my ear.
What happened? What?
How the hell that happened?
I just bashed myself.
No, a little bit better. Lift it up one more time.
Hey, drum mic.
You're always getting bashed.
Lift it up one more time. Let me see that.
One more time. Like Bastion, already on the engine list again. Dude, you're fucking mad.
Light up. Get that, Jay? Hey, Bad.
Get me in some of these.
Everyone, I'm fucking
Thank you. You guys together.
Yes,
you This guy right here is the king of business. Should be on Wall Street. He is the banker with the tattoo.
Nice man.
Long hair. Gary Sharon.
The man,
the myth, the legend.
Thank you for being with us.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
受けたミュージシャンというかね、ちょっと聞いてみましょうか。うん、そうすると、ああ、なるほどなって。
client is going to answer this right now, this moment.
What was the question? The root of the metal industry reaching out on its own to say that we're here and it's big and...
Yeah, it obviously exists because this is such a major success.
If you don't like what you hear here, get the fuck out!
Thank you.
tonight. See y'all later, boys and girls. Do it.
Hey, this is Nuno Bettencourt of Extreme, and you'll be watching Hot Guitarist Video Guitarist. Try it again. Yo, I know I'm talking with my mouth full, but this is Nuno Bettencourt of Extreme, and you'll be watching Hot Guitarist Video, and I'm spitting out nuts all over the place. What is that? Hey, this is Nuno Bettencourt of Extreme, and you'll be watching Hot Guitarist Video Magazine. Do you know?
All right.
Youngest of 10 kids in my family, I was lucky enough to go into one room and listen to the Beatles, and go somewhere else and listen to, you know, Simon and Garfunkel or Zeppelin or Aerosmith. I had so many brothers and sisters that, as opposed to just, you know, a person my age growing up and what is around me, I had the luck to just have everything. See, Eddie Van Halen's like a given. I don't think you even have to state. I think he'd pretty much made guitar playing this decade, or last decade, the way it was. He set the tone for it. So Al DiMeola, a lot of stuff like Brian May from the Queen stuff. I usually listen to a lot of guitar players that are in bands also. A couple of people I'd love to really play with is probably Prince. I'd love to do something with someday. Someone recently I had met that I was always a big fan of her drumming was Sheila E. I saw with Prince, and I think she's really talented as a drummer. Plus, she's gorgeous, by the way, if you didn't notice. And but that's not important. It's her talent that matters, believe me. The only word there is extreme, you know, and that's why the name is there. You know what I mean? People always want to categorize you. Just like, I mean, it's very natural to listen to someone and say, hey, you know, they're very this or they're very that. It's natural. But I think it's going to take a career. I think one of our goals is to just, you know, I mean, I don't compare us to Zeppelin or the Beatles or whatever, but when you think back in those bands, that's what they were. You can't put Zeppelin in any category, and you can't put, you know, I know it takes a career, but eventually we hope to just become extreme.
Say it out.
love and fall out of love every day, and they can relate to that song. They can, first of all, it's quiet enough and not scary enough for radio stations to play. It's what we call MTV friendly, because Decadence can get the funk out warrant. It's just the way it is, you know. But at the same time, when we did this album, you know, people are like, are you upset that it's a ballad that didn't? It's not a ballad, it's a song. Bad. They played their lighters. They got little anvil cases for the lighters and everything they take on tour with them. And you know, it's one of those things where we wanted the way things happen. There's the way it is, and the way the way you wish it was. And More Than Words is that video that did it. We wanted to incorporate the band obviously in any way. And usually they do mock us when we play the song anyway, so that worked out well. But as long as they're in there, and people know that this is a band thing.
Close your eyes and just reach out.
A month and a half ago, before we went to Europe, we were talking about a third record. Next thing we know, we get to Europe. 2 days into Europe, the record goes gold. The song is climbing up to, you know, it's a top 10 song, goes to number one. We find out it's on the verge of going platinum, and within a month. We're obviously very proud. We wanted this record especially to get heard, and that's what matters, the fact that it's going platinum. And as far as what it means to us, we haven't really seen it yet. You know, we're going back home to do this show, and we're getting the records handed to us. Maybe we'll get more of a sense of what's really happening. And to get, like, to the song to go to number one and see it in Billboard, that's, there's no words to really explain that feeling. Day of our lives. I think it's the biggest working day of our lives. I mean, you kind of get up at 7 or 8 o'clock, and you start shooting. But it's actually all right. I think by the 40th or 50th take, it's still okay. But I think by the 80th, you've had it. You know what I mean? And it's really grueling. And the problem is you can't really lay off, because you know, they could use the end takes mostly, which they do a lot. So you got to always keep it up and keep it going through the whole day. The video is very one dimensional. You know, and you're seeing this one view. Live, it's a different thing, you know. I think the band loves to perform, and it's just like you just can't capture what you're seeing live on video. It's a shame that we're doing this tour, we don't really get to do what we really want to do. We're just trying to really fit a, you know, 80 pounds into a 60 pound bag kind of thing. We're doing edits and doing things here and there, but you know, so hopefully when we get to a point where actually we have our stage and we have what we want to do, you're going to see Extreme as where it's really supposed to be at. Where we do what we can afford to bring our horn section along, where we can afford to bring a piano along, where we can really afford to become us. But this, the cool thing about this is you're seeing Extreme as raw as it can be and just going out and kicking ass. A couple of companies had approached me to do some endorsements, and I didn't want to because I never used anything that anybody put out. Whenever I went to a store or bought some, I used to change it so much and cut it up and do all sorts of things to it. So they you know, Washburn was the only one who said, well, you know, we don't want to force you to play anything, but what if we, you know, put out the guitar that you built? I love it. I mean, it took him a while back and forth, about 2 years to get it right, so I made sure I was in love with it. ADA MP1 right now with the same power amp, and I'm using these old Ampeg speakers, the original V4 cabs, and just throw an ME5 rolling thing just for some delay, because, you know, live you need it. I've always liked people that just, instead of just favorite solos, I like people that just play solos that fit so well with songs that it's like a whole vibe you get. Like, for instance, the Hotel California, it's such a great song, and that solo itself, the solo thing, solo out, could be a whole song of its own. You know, melody after melody after, it's just so memorable, and that's what I like, is just stuff that's memorable. There's times in songs to just go crazy, and there's times to just do things that just mellow out, you know. And I think I just respect guitar players that just play for the song. The notes have always been on the guitar, all the music has always been here. We're just discovering it, you know what I mean? And that's what it's about. Nobody should really take credit for inventing something or coming up with something, because you are what you eat. You didn't invent it, you have these influences when you're younger and as you grow up, and you spit them out later in life, and that's pretty much how it is. And it's not science, you know, it's just a lot of, it's creation, but it's in your own way. So if you have a lot of different things that you eat, you know what I mean, then you mix them up, and you know, if you worship just one band, you're gonna sound like that one band. You know, if you're an Eddie Van Halen kind of worshiper, then that's what you're gonna be, just that. Guitar player, if any advice, is just be a musician and don't be just a guitar player. Because if you're just a guitar player, then you limit yourself. Even with your guitar playing, you can come up with so many things by listening to singers, by singing, by playing drums is important for any musician, because it's all related to time and grooves and, you know, being able to play with a band. So be a musician and don't be stupid. Go for the whole thing. You know what I mean? Don't just be a guitar head.
That's your love.
You know what I want? I just want to be able to just do what I'm doing forever. You know what I mean? I don't think, I've always heard about people burning out and not, I can't imagine me doing that or the band doing that. I mean, I'm sure someday the band will get to a point where we'll slow down a little bit, but as far as doing things, I can't, some days I can't sleep at night because I got so much shit going through my head that I want to do and things and songs and projects and so many people I love to work with that I think if I can just sustain, you know, being able to stay healthy and just do what I'm doing, I think that's all I want. The people in it have a lot to offer, we feel, and a lot of new stuff and a lot of different things we want to do. And the second we get a chance to, you know, that's what this is about, the whole platinum thing and selling records. It's not about the money at all. I mean, everybody wants to be comfortable and have their houses and, you know, can eat well for once. But it's really about just staying around and playing, giving something back.
Extreme.
And you're watching Metalhead.
Absolutely.
Metalhead.
And I'm Chevy Chase. You're not!
It's a band that I really like from the first second I saw them.
You're at beautiful Scream Studio on Ventura Boulevard.
So I got in contact with E&M, who was the record company, and actually they wanted me to remix one of their songs of the first record.
Michael Wagner.
And the man, the myth,
the legend.
Oh, he's got $5. All right.
He's
amazing. No, I'm telling you, he's what a producer is supposed to be.
I told him to keep me in mind for the next record, and that's what they did.
Mike Wagner, this is your life.
Done 69 records. I mixed the first Motley Crue record. I've done Stryper, Soldiers on the Command. I did 2 Alice Cooper records, Skid Row's first record, 2 White Line records. Mixed Megadeth records, mixed Metallica, Master of Puppets. Actually, I'm doing the 69s right now, which is the Porno Graffiti for Extreme.
We record it right here.
This record was done in a slightly different way than I've done other records before. Normally what you do in the studio, you go and record the drums first, then overdub bass and guitar, and then overdub vocals. This was more done as in terms of a live kind of form where drums and bass and guitars were morally recorded together as a band.
This is a description of what we look like when we're recording.
Mm-hmm.
That's called cusping.
That's
full cusp. That's being on the cusp of insanity while we're recording.
And they're really well prepared.
I see wheat. I see fields of wheat.
Theoretically speaking.
Which is irrelevant to the period.
And Porno Graffiti is what's surrounding us.
You pick up Nags, I'm looking for a singer, must have long hair, an image must be right, must not have a mustache, must have drive a vehicle. Now,
tell us what really matters.
What really matters how big the schlong is, dude. That's really
Gary Sharon.
What I got to say about Mike what I do say shouldn't have any influence on the mix.
Should it?
But Mike, as far as a producer and what he's done with us, is rather than change us and make us sound like his last project, he's enhanced what we do and made us sound more like Extreme, and that's what I think a producer
would it be
his job is.
Extreme 3D, is that what you're saying?
3D.
Before we were like this, now we're like this. Who's in there?
Oh, curse!
Metalhead.
Do you think that the fact that we are so diverse has held us back at all?
I'm glad you asked that question, because Pat's going to answer for
you. I think I...
Say I love you is not the words I want to hear from you. It's not that I want you not to say, but if you only knew how
it's that much sweeter now, too, after struggling and scratching away to the top. Now that you know, you finally have like a number one single and stuff, it just
it's like going door to door and selling every record. We earned every record.
We actually did that. We used to go door to door.
Do you like to buy one?
Cause I'd already
know. It's really funny. We used to go to Burger King. Really, this is seriously. We all go in because Pat was the only one with a car when he joined the band. And we used to go there and we'd be digging in the seats for the change, and we get the whole amount. We get the whole amount together and figure out that we could like each get a burger or something, and there was no money left for a drink.
No drink, we used to say.
So that was the thing. You can have a hamburger, but
no drink.
Well, there was a time when, you know, when I'd go out to a nightclub and I'd pick up your sixes and sevens. You know, now a little hit record, I can get an eight and a nine. Just like
the
that. It's amazing.
And the 11,
know,
once the 10, while, that's you know. Waffles. It's amazing. Censorship is a bullshit thing that it. And if I see this video later and if I'm saying all these things, then we'll see what that comes from.
That's your love for me.
Musical integrity is a weird thing, and it's, I think if you always do whatever you do, you know, whatever you love to do, if you always do that, you're always going to maintain that, no matter what it is. I don't think if it's a pop or a mainstream thing, doesn't mean that you don't have any integrity. It's a number one hit. It's like people are going to say, well, it's a number one hit, it's the first song they heard from us in the States. Are they just like selling out? You know what I mean?
Did they buy the song from Joe Blow, songwriter, producer?
Nay. No.
It's funny when you go on tour sometimes, like one day you'll be playing this big place and the next night you'll walk into this dingy little hole and you know you get kind of bummed out or whatever, but we've always like worked each show, each live show we always think of as like on a bigger level than it actually is. You know, we'll make an arena out of a theater, we'll make a theater out of a club.
Yeah.
have your mom. Your mom's always there. She'll always be there. You know what I'm saying?
And she thought you were great when you really weren't.
Yeah.
That's okay.
But she'll spank you then, she'll spank you now.
You ask it.
That's right.
How long ago did you form the band?
Do you like musical answers?
Late 85, early 86, that's when the band.
And how was it at the beginning?
How was it? Well,
jazzy.
It was a jazz fusion type of thing.
Who were you mainly influenced during those
probably
days?
Same bands we're still influenced by.
Probably, you got your Beatles, you got your Simon & Garfunkels, you got your Zeppelins, you got your Aerosmiths,
Queen.
You got your Princes, you got your Queens, you got your
kind of like
Journeys.
The stuff we grew up on, you know.
Which major changes do you think happened in your music since you started?
Major changes?
Before
any of our success in the States, we used to go to McDonald's and order 2 hamburgers, large fry, but no drink. Now, the major changes, now we get 2 hamburgers, large fry, a drink.
Which are the songs that you feel are more representative of Extreme in the last album?
On the new record, I think the dominating sound would be the Harder Edge, the Get the Funk Outs, the Decadence Dance.
Yeah.
That would be the majority. We consider ourselves a hard rock band, but not just that. That's why we go off into some tangents.
What do you usually write about in your lyrics?
I just try to be, just like how Nuno gets inspired musically, we try to keep it honest. I just try to be honest with myself. I'm not afraid to tackle anything that I'm affected by, whether it be a touchy subject or whatever. And as long as you're honest with yourself, you know, you can't go wrong. I think the audience will accept it. I don't try to write about things I don't know about.
How do you write the songs? Does Nuno come up with a riff? Do you rehearse all the band together?
Yeah, I'd say the majority of the material happens with Nuno coming up with a riff and put it on a four track with the ideas and then bringing it to me. And whatever on my mind at the time usually comes out. He usually has so much material, he's always kicking me in the ass to write, you know. After that, we deliver it to the other two mentally incompetent, extreme guys.
And they kill it.
Pat and Paul add their thing to it. And by the time we come out of rehearsal with this song, it sounds nothing like what we intended, but it becomes an extreme song.
What's the rock scene like in the States?
Telephone.
Let me see. As far as when we started out...
No, don't answer, man.
No, you don't have to get the phone.
Oh, it's his beeper.
Oh, it's his beeper. All we can talk about, I guess, the scene in Boston. When we were starting doing the club scene, there was a lot of rock. Well, not actually, there wasn't a lot of anything. There was just a lot of different types of things. There was... a punk scene in Boston and rock and a new wave scene. And during like 85, 86, and 87, we were doing the thing. There wasn't that many clubs we could play, but somehow we survived.
I think a lot of bands right now in the States are not coming from Los Angeles or New York, and they're coming from smaller and different towns like Boston in your case, or Seattle, yeah, or other towns.
Georgia. I don't know. It always changes. The industry always chases where if a big band comes out of somewhere, they all go after something else in that area, thinking that it thinking it's some kind of disease or something, everybody's gonna have it, you know, which it isn't true. All that happens is Guns N' Roses comes out of L.A., and you get a lot of Guns N' Roses clone bands, you know, that are around there. Yeah.
Mostly among your colleagues, other rock bands.
The honest ones.
Censorship, it's too hip to talk about right now, you know what I mean? Because you got people who are trying to censor records, and then you got the people who aren't that popular that are taking advantage of the censorship and swearing even more on a record so they can get attention to fight the censorship. So, you know, it don't make a difference to us whether it's there.
Yeah, we really never got affected by it. Only a few radio stations didn't want to play Get the Funk Out because of the innuendo.
Are you writing new material on the road?
Oh, yeah. Always.
Yeah, we're actually...
right now. Check this out.
What do you think sets Extreme apart from other rock bands?
I think it would be the size of our noses would be the biggest thing.
Definitely.
Turn. Show it.
Actually, it might be our nostrils. I don't know.
Let me see.
Seriously?
What separates us?
Yep.
You know what? It's like we always believe that any band, you can always see when a band is doing what they really are good at. You know what I mean? Like, it's one thing to just want to be in a rock band and have long hair and buy a guitar and have all the chicks and all the drinking you want and be cool and be in magazines. But in the end, the stuff that's going to live on is the stuff that really people love what they're doing and the music that they're creating, and not worrying about copying other people and not worrying about... And at the same time, not being ashamed of their influences and taking them into the 90s, not trying to recreate the past, or, you know, we're just being idiots.
You win, you found the message, or something like that. Do you ever try to send out messages or anything, or you think that music must be only entertainment?
It should always remain. I mean, you got to put it in perspective. You know, we're not politicians, and you know, we're musicians first, and we're entertainers. Obviously, if you're a live band, in our case, that's what we put across first. But I do feel that you have a podium. You have things to say, and I don't care for some of the bands that, you know, rehash the same old story. And as far as Extreme's concerned, you know, there's plenty of things to say in the world, and there's a lot more to life than just, you know, sex, drugs, and rock and roll. And
there is?
I think we, yeah, I heard about that. But I think Extreme takes advantage of that, you know. I don't think you should get too heavy because it's still music and it should be,
you should enjoy it. You know, I think you should enjoy it, but if you want to look into it, it's good to have something, some substance there to look into. But, you know, the first priority is to really, to move your butt to it, you know. Right, Ray?
that your love for me is real. What would you say if I took those words away? Then you couldn't make things new just by saying I love you.
Songs, refreshingly enough, has been working for years to make the big time, and now with its top 10 single More Than Words, Extreme definitely seems to have arrived. But are these guys actually famous yet? Well, we took them out to meet the public in New York City's Central Park recently, and here's what happened.
Even though the band's second LP, Porno Graffiti, is rising the charts, recognition seems hard to come by.
Here we are at the Great Lawn. This is Nuno Betancourt. My name's Gary.
Extreme.
We got a record out. It's called Porno Graffiti. We're going to try to find at least maybe one or one and a half people that know who we are. You guys look normal.
We are normal.
We need to talk to you just a second. No problem? Guys, I think you're on television.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay.
You guys know
simple
the song?
Yeah. You do?
Yeah.
Extreme.
Two blonde guys. Close.
Two guys.
Nothing. Can we ask the iguana question? The Senor Dredd, have you ever heard this song before?
You heard this tune before, man. You digging it.
Frank
Zappa? Close, getting warmer.
Can I hear that on MTV
Unplugged? I don't know, right?
Electro rap that leads into heavy metal.
Is it a new band?
Yeah, like rap and metal.
We're getting closer now.
I have your album. I love you guys. I just wanted to tell you that.
Would they be talking like this if there wasn't a camera pointing at
them? And there's soul in my heart. Can't be still with the things I do.
That's it. That's
all
Thank you very much. Thank you. Staying here at the Great YC. Next is
Week in Rock. Tell them what they won, Gary.
News. The Boston band Extreme knocks Mariah Carey out of the top spot on the Billboard chart on Monday with the group's hit single, More Than Words, and also cracks the top 10 with its second album, Porno Graffiti. But this remains a hard band to pigeonhole stylistically. Is it a rock act, an ace vocal group? Well, guitarist Nuno Betancourt discusses that subject on a new home video music clip compilation called Photo Graffiti, and here's what he has to say.
I don't like labels. I mean, I know you need them, and I know even William should label people. You get, you know, when we go into a station, they say, you know, you're a metal band, you know, why are you doing this? It really upsets me because it just, like, it's music, you know, music is music.
Photo Graffiti contains some previously unreleased videos from Extreme, among them a clip for Decadence Dance, directed by Alex Winter, the host of MTV's The Idiot Box. Extreme will be launching a U.S. tour on June 13th as the opening act for David Lee Roth.
Billboard Magazine 100 singles chart, Extreme could be in danger of getting typecast as a soft pop ballad band. After all, the song is all acoustic strumming and lilting Everly Brothers harmonies. But if you listen to Extreme's latest album, Porno Graffiti, you'll find convincing forays into hard rock, dance funk, and a wide variety of other genres. Ample evidence that, as Extreme themselves recently told us, there's more to them than More Than Words.
They always try to put you, probably because of our hair, you know, they teach you this hair band thing, and you're a metal band thing, but we're just Extreme, you know, and hopefully someday that... Well, I know it's going to take a career, but hopefully someday we'll be just called Extreme. And, like, you know, we're not comparing ourselves to the Zeppelin or anything, but you can't put those types of bands in bands, rock bands, because they just did everything. They did whatever they felt like doing. That's what it should be about.
First and foremost, we're a hard rock band.
Extreme is now on the road opening for Cinderella and David Lee Roth, and they'll play Bristol.
Out of the room after this segue.
Watch this segue. This is professional.
Finest. Go ahead. Well, it's just two words, if they're words. AC
DC.
AC/DC. Okay. So what video is this gonna be?
I think it's Shook Me All Night Long. Let me explain something to you about AC/DC. They've been there from the beginning. They were brought up in arenas. They were made for arenas. They survived the disco era, right? They didn't start doing this disco stuff.
They didn't change for nobody.
You can always count on them. Angus always has those shorts on. He hasn't changed them in like 10 years. And they're the greatest, one of the greatest.
That's right. And they're on tour right now. Just like us.
Just like us.
What a coincidence.
But
their tour doesn't end when our tour does. Our tour ends like, let me tell you.
We end in like December.
This is the second leg of our tour. We're doing a tour with Danger Danger.
It's not really the leg, it's the ankle.
More like an ankle.
Right.
It's not the meat. It's the meat of it. But we're on tour currently. We're going to be playing tonight, right? We're playing tonight?
We're playing tonight.
When does it say?
Today.
That's right.
And you can go shop and see the Union American.
Crisscrossing the United States and Canada, lines intertwining, simple lines.
It's like the right house but the wrong address.
Okay. But it all ends before Christmas. So, yo, Angus, this is Darian Nuno. We're ready to go for the year, man.
We love you guys, all right?
We heard rumors that you guys really wanted us on this tour.
And we accept.
And wait.
We're doing it by
via. Don't accept. I have to check my schedule. We're free. Artists like Prince and
Queen.
Yeah. But some people might hear some of that in our music, and that's great. It's the biggest compliment. But I think more of the philosophy, like how they were never limited with what they wanted to do. They never got stuck in a mold of rock.
It's like having the can I say balls? It's like having a balls to do something like When I First Kissed You. I think a lot of people have that in them, but they're just so afraid because it's not hip. You know what I mean? And then when you do something like that, then it becomes hip. If the album does well, then it'll be a cool thing.
Now it's coming to a peak here. It's a peak.
We're climaxing now. It's orgasmic.
And we have a lot of information, a lot of important information we want you to
listen,
hear.
If you're at home, you're bored, what? November 26th, go see Tommy Floyd at Club Soda in Vancouver.
That's right, but that's not all.
Tell them what they want, Gary.
And Annihilator will be playing Saturday, November 24th at the Apocalypse Club in Toronto.
And also we got, why did they make me say this one? Sepultura. Did I say it right?
Are you reading, dude?
I'm not reading.
Dude, look at the camera. Look at the camera. Yeah, good.
I'm supposed to have my cue card.
Go ahead.
Sepultura, Monday, November 26th, Apocalypse Club in Toronto, man. Go check it out.
I'll show you how to do it, dude. Jeez, professional people. You got Sunday, November 25th with
Faith No More.
Who is Superstars in... Dude, I can't pronounce that.
That was supposed to be Annihilator,
with
right?
That's Mississauga?
Mississauga.
I knew that. I was just testing you kids out there.
Somebody took the word Mississippi and put Aga at the end of it.
That's right. Next, we got another date. There's more dates.
We got Sacrifice, man. Go see Sacrifice Saturday, December 15th at Bannister's in Hamilton, Ontario.
That's right.
Tell them what they won with all those dates.
Well, they don't go home alone empty-handed. They got the Game Boy version of Tetris. Back to you.
Tipsy Rose, this Sunday, right? This Sunday at the Diamond has been postponed till the new year, so why did they make me say this Sunday at the Diamond? Oh, I get it, so they'd know.
Oh, by the way, this is the Pepsi Power Hour Challenge. Nuno's gonna try different orange juices here.
Pepsi makes orange juice now, it's the Pepsi Power Hour.
And we's be extreme, this is Nuno, and I'm Gary, and we got a new video out.
Oh, we got a new video, this is it, this is the one.
Oh, is this the debut of it?
Yeah.
Wow,
we're excited.
Great.
This is the debut. We haven't seen it. They haven't let us see it. I don't speak English. I'm from Portugal.
And as far as the...
I have my green card, though, so don't arrest me, please.
As far as the outfit, I think it would be like a combination of like a Clockwork Orange and Charlie Brown, if you notice the shoes.
On Halloween, though.
On Halloween, yes. And this is a fun video. We had a good time doing it.
Andy Moyan did it.
He's
a genius.
Yeah.
He's one of those
Andy,
guys just sitting there looking at the camera.
We like to say hi to Susie in this video.
Just doing Andy Moore.
Oh, you're doing the Andy Moore.
Susie's in it. Francis is in it. He-Man's in it.
It'll all work out after you see the whole thing. It'll all be put into the proper
Just look at the album cover. It's a great video. We love it. It's our favorite because it's the newest one. That's why it's our favorite.
And actually, because of all this tape thing going on, Milli Vanilli, we refuse to do a video. So we're doing this live. Every time you see this on television, we are in a little corner of a room. They set up the big major production, $80,000 every time that this video will be on. And probably be heavy rotation at Much Music.
Okay. $1,000 a whack? No problem. They can handle it. They're much.
This is Get the Funk Out. Excuse me. Excuse me.
Thank you. Thank you.